Let me first introduce myself. I am, as a background, neuroscientist. I teach psychobiology in the Complutense University of Madrid. You have pronounced quite well. It's a long, long, strange name for non-Spanish, but it's a Latin name. And I do research as a visiting fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. The main topic of my research since almost 40 years ago is aggression in different animal species. And obviously one of the animal species which I interest in the most is the human species. And in humans, I do cross-cultural studies on aggression, on the justification of aggression. I've done that at inter-individual level, and nowadays I am obviously also interested about inter-social, inter-nations levels, and that's why I'm learning a lot about violence and terrorism, and perhaps that's the reason why you have invited me to be here. Ivo Slaus suggested me to tell you about the Seville Statement on Violence. As you may remember, this statement was elaborated in the 80s by scientists from all the world and from many different disciplines. Among them, for instance, Federico Mayor, that we heard him yesterday, or Robert Heim, who is the chair of the British Powers Group, and Leakey, from also world famous from Kenya, well, many others. We were more than 20 people. And the main message of this statement states that peace is possible, and that wars and violence, therefore, can be ended, making it clear that there is nothing in biology that stands in the way of making a world without war. Besides of that, it is not said by the statement, but Professor Slaus, war is useless. This statement has been successfully followed by its endorsement by the 25th General Conference of UNESCO in the 1989, and by the creation of UNESCO's Culture for Peace program in the 1994, I guess, as well as the decade of Science for Peace, which came later. And which is the context we started? We started preparing this statement in the 70s of the last century. The context at that time, as you remember, was the Cold War. Politicians wanted to believe, I guess, that the war would justify the manufacture and the deployment of nuclear weapons, among other things. And to justify that, they were that war was something inevitable, was an inevitable consequence of human nature, so that we were violent beings by nature, and we did not have any other alternative in violence. And of course, the watching around you, you see, we saw at that time the devastating forms of structural violence, which became part of our daily life. Many violent social models, even violent entertainments. Nowadays, you can see many video games, for instance, violent games. And so, and people were continuing accepting that that culture of violence that we were observing was something unavoidable. So that was the fact, the context where we were. And then we were members of the International Society for Research on Aggression, and we, those scholars dedicated to research on aggression, thought that it was our responsibility as scientists to speak out on the basis of the latest information, although aware that conclusions in science are never final. And our aim was to elaborate a document stating which was the scientific state of art in the field of human aggression, violence, because we thought that was a needed message of hope to be given to the humankind as opposed to the myth of war as something naturally inevitable. We did have a lot of obstacles in our attempts. The first obstacle came from the same UNESCO. We decided, our society, International Society for Research on Aggression, to launch a UN committee that, among other goals, would aim at organizing a series of symposiums under the umbrella of UNESCO. And it was hoped that this symposium would eventually lead towards a UNESCO statement on human violence. We drafted a provisional program and we submitted that to the head of the Division of Human Rights and Peace and to the Director General of UNESCO. And both of them, they responded in the most favorable and encouraging way. But then, internal political discussions within the UNESCO concerning our proposal led to a letter of the Director General Mbowo at that time, telling us that the proposed topic was too touchy for being dealt with under the auspices of UNESCO. And the second obstacle, similar to this one, came a little bit later from the Vatican. The president, at that time, president of the Pontifical Academy of Science, invited us to draft also a motivated proposal for a symposium devoted to the biological and social sociocultural determinants of violence. And we soon heard that also the Pope at that time was John Paul II, or if he was, had read the proposal and he fully approved of both its structural and mainly the general spirit of the proposal and encouraged us to proceed. But then it came silent and silent, and then we understood that also for the Vatican it was not timely to deal with those determinants of violence. However, instead of giving up, we scientists from many disciplines, we thought that we should keep discussing freely about and openly about this topic, and especially we would like to deep about whether the natural and the social sciences knew of any biological obstacle, serious obstacle to this goal of world peace. And at that time there were not emails and nothing. I mean, we had to write letters because we were people from Australia to Kenya, to America, Europe, so waiting maybe a couple of months until the answer came, and it was not so easy. And therefore, the preparation of our statement lasted about 3 years, something like that. And finally, in the 86, a draft was elaborated sent to all of us for this study and eventually got approval. And we met in Seville. At that time I was professor at the Seville University. And after 1 week of practical seclusion, like here, some of us are in the COVID secure, we finally approved this statement of virus. And what we did, summarizing the statement, I would say we studied virus at the individual or in the individual level and an intersocial level, which the main example is work. In the first step, we did a few observations, noting that it was incorrect. First, that violence is something genetically programmed in human nature. We clearly distinguish between the propensity or predispositions that we all have, either to be violent or to be lovely people or to be whatever we feel to be, which is not exactly how we behave, how is our behavioral outcomes. And we pointed out that aggressiveness as a feeling and aggressive behavior as an act was not the only behavior, and even less the most important behavior that we humans have, but there were other that we could summarize telling or calling them prosocial behavior, which were also very important. And all of them, they are due not because of genetical reasons, but because of an interaction between genetics and environment. When I say environment, I want to say culture, experience, and so on. That was the first. The second thing was to say that it was incorrect to think that in the course of the human evolution, aggression is selected over other kinds of behavior. I just mentioned you that cooperation and altruism, for instance, that prosocial behavior that I mentioned before, is more important in humans than aggression. Those social bondings and affiliation, not only in humans, but also in animals, when you study dominance in other species, in our own species, you see that, of course, they are aggressive or violent acts, but it's more important just this link of affiliation among all of that. And there are also very well known theories like the kin selection of Huntington in the 60s that insist that the cooperation is the way we have to promote not only humans but also animals, to promote our own genes for the future. Or Edward Wilson, for instance, of Harvard, with his multi-level selection theory, insists that generosity allows us to get a better arrangement in our life, better than ordinary violence. A third point that was also incorrect, we state, was that there is a violent brain that compels us to act violently. No. Aggressive behavior and any other behavior is not automatically activated by neural stimuli. Brain acts through filtered conditions, for instance, for the in our case, the socialization, the culture, which, and in the case of aggressiveness, which is the field, and I think that if you ask me for a title of my talk now, this could be a very appropriate title. The most important point I want to tell you, that aggressiveness can be biologically tamed. So we can be very aggressive, but I mean, thanks to psychobiology, to biology and obviously through education, we don't have to behave as badly as we may want in some sometimes. And well, Yeah, and one of the things is what we pointed out related with interpersonal violence. And in the another level, in the level of, let us say, war, we insist that it hasn't been found in animals, the war that we do, we humans do. Understanding by war, fighting between organized groups using adequate tools, weapons. Animals, they don't have it. And sometimes they can throw something, I'm thinking about monkeys, stones or whatever, but in a very disorganized way and quite an effective way. We found also that war is not a necessary consequence of human condition. War is a product of culture. In other words, that there are other alternatives, other ways to solve the problem, to set disputes, much better than the war. A third point related to the war is that very rarely aggressiveness is the first and main cause of the war. Usually war is done by multiple interacting causes. And as I said, aggressiveness is, if any, is a very minor important one. It's just a tool to do the war. And I would say it's more a consequence in the act of aggression of the war than the cause of one war. Why? Because far from being one single motivation, war usually they are caused by multiple motivations. The duty, the fear, the loyalty, the desire of revenge, looking for territories. Politicians who may won the war, and just thinking about feelings, let us say, usually there's a predominance of the cognition of how to do or why to do it to, on the aggressiveness of the war. And we can see that war is really an institution with numerous different roles. There is the role of the politician, and each role with its specific duties and rights. The commanders, let's say the generals, the soldiers, the physicians, well, I'm a medical doctor, that way I include myself, has to be there just looking after the people who make the war, the munition workers who prepare the nuclear wars and weapons and non-nuclear weapons, any weapon. The transport workers, so there are many different kinds of people who are working, let us say, in the war, and each one does what he does primarily because of his duty in the role that he or she occupies in the institution of war. So, I could keep going, but since I have to refrain myself, and I'm afraid I haven't refrained myself too much to the time given to us, I will just finish my talk saying that aggression is evitable, violence is evitable, aggressiveness could be tamed, as I told you before, that far from condemning humanity to war, biology makes possible to end violence and to achieve peace. How? That is a second more important and difficult chapter which does not belong to this discussion. Thank you.